Hi, I'm Michael Crouch, and I am a psychotherapist who practices in Stamford, Connecticut. I am certified in EMDR and with an expertise in trauma. And so I want to talk to you about what courage looks like. When Gauri Mittai won the Nobel Peace Prize in 2004, and she said, "There is no courage without conviction." The root of courage is cor, and in Latin that means heart. So there is no courage without conviction, without heart, without a purpose. 3 years ago, I received a phone call from a friend and a fellow therapist who said, "Michael, did you hear what happened?" And it was Christmas Day. So I said, "I haven't been paying attention to the news." She said, "There was a fire in Stamford. And there were three little girls, sisters, and their grandparents who perished in that fire." She said there were 70 firemen on that call, both the rescue attempts and the recovery operation, and that they were having a hard time. So the next day I showed up at the debriefing planning meeting, and I listened to the stories of what that day was like. And I wondered what it must have been like for those firefighters as they pulled up to that house. The mother of those children screaming. And they tried. They worked really hard to try to rescue those little girls. And I wondered what that moment was like when they realized there was nothing they could do. And then when the smaller team went in to recover those children and their grandparents, and I wondered what it must have been like to pick those little girls up. So the next day, three of my friends and fellow therapists went to the debriefing. They were there to offer support, help them understand what trauma looks like for them, offer therapy, help if they needed it. Well, that was the beginning of my work with first responders. I had a colleague of mine who said, "Michael, you should start an EMDR Trauma Recovery Network, a TRN. So I said, "Okay." I didn't know what it was, but I found out very quickly. And what an honor it's been for me. And we started to reach out to that fire department, offering treatment for those very few who might come in and get the help that we could offer. We did a trauma workshop with the new trainees. And you can imagine they're new, so they haven't been on the calls, and they are full of that bravado that says, "Boy, I'm going to go fight fires, and it's going to be great." So they really weren't into understanding what trauma is about. And in the back, their training officer, a captain who'd been around for a while, he said, "Hey guys, listen. Listen to what they're saying. Don't think that this can't happen to you." And he began to go on and talk about the images and the memories that haunt him. Robbie Adler Tapia is a wonderful therapist in Arizona who's dedicated her work to first responders. She was a firefighter before she was a therapist, as was her father and her grandfather. And she calls those images, she talks about this parade of faces. All those calls that haunt, the memories, the images that you just can't get out of your mind. A year after that Christmas Day fire, I got a call. And it was that same friend. And she said, "Michael, did you hear what happened?" Well, I'd been listening to the radio that morning and had heard about the tragedies at Sandy Hook, Newtown. So we started reaching out to the Newtown community. To this point, I think we've treated well over 150, including all first responders, FBI SWAT, state troopers, local and surrounding police departments, EMTs, 911 operators, clergy, and children, parents who lost children. A couple weeks after that shooting, I got a phone call from the wife of a Newtown police officer. She said, "My husband's having a hard time. He went back to work, but he soon realized he just couldn't do it. He was having flashbacks of that day." She said he couldn't make normal, everyday decisions, what to eat, what to wear. So I met with him, and he started to tell me his story. He said that on that morning he had breakfast, as he usually does at a diner, went back to the police department, doing some paperwork when the call came in. So he got in his cruiser, and he's heading down that main street in Newtown to the flagpole, and he made a right turn. He said, "I am going towards that school," but he realized he's driving pretty fast. And he wasn't breathing, and his focus had narrowed down, so he wasn't paying attention. You see, he didn't want to be T-boned, as he said. So he began to do what he called warrior breathing. And he began to get ready to do his job. His vision opened up. He got his rifle ready. So when he pulled into that parking lot, shot still firing, he grabbed his rifle, got out of his police cruiser, and went towards that school, towards the shooting. That's what courage looks like. There was a moment where there was a pistol shot, and then there was silence. He kept moving towards the school. He met up with an EMT who was there. Now, firefighters and EMTs are trained that they don't go into a situation unless it's clear. But that EMT knew that he might be needed. So that police officer raises his rifle, ready to go in. That EMT tucks into his side. Police officer says, "You ready? We're going." And they proceed into that school. That's what courage looks like. And we all know what they found. There were a number of first responders who showed up that day. state troopers, police, local Newtown and surrounding areas, firefighters, EMTs. Later in the day, there were not as many left. And their job then was to take care of those kids and to begin the investigation into what happened. And I can't imagine what it must have been like to stand there and take care of those kids. Karen Lansing is a therapist who's dedicated her life to working with first responders, law enforcement, and the military. And she says that courage is hanging on just one moment more. Just one moment more. And I keep thinking that that's what they did. That all they could do around that much human suffering was to hang on one moment more. The First Responder Foundation has statistics that show that first responders suffer from cardiovascular disease, hypertension, diabetes, obesity, domestic violence, alcoholism, depression, anxiety, post-traumatic stress disorder, PTSD. The Chicago Fire Department did a study from 1990 to 2010, and they said that their firefighters, both active and retired, suicided 25 times more than the general population, and that the life expectancy of first responders is 15 years shorter than yours and mine. Those numbers are not okay. That police officer I worked with, he's doing okay. He got back to work. I called him a couple weeks ago, and he said, I'm beginning to understand, Michael, the difference between typical average police officer stress and Newtown memories. I said, you know, your typical average police officer stress is not so typical and not so average. Don't take it for granted. He said, you're right, maybe I need to come in for a tune-up. I said, that'd be great. Right? But he went on to say, Michael, it's not just about Newtown, is it? He said, it's easy to see those of us who responded to the Newtown tragedy, or the firefighters and the police officers who went up those towers on September 11th, it's easy to call them heroes. But we don't see our local firefighters, police officers, state troopers, our first responders the same way, do we? Imagine being a police officer in a small town somewhere. You're by yourself, it's a dark country road, and there's a car up ahead. You have to stop and get out, walk towards that car. You don't know who or what is in that car, do you? Or you're a firefighter and you're in a fire and you don't know if the ceiling's gonna come down, the floor is gonna go out from underneath you. But that's courage. Ironically, today, the governor of Connecticut, Dan Malloy, declared today, Saturday, September 27th, 2014, First Responder Day. And I do applaud that. I really appreciate it. But I think we've got to know that our first responders, they show up 365 days a year. So I'm asking first responders, that culture, and I want to include the military because I think we're letting them down. I want you to know that trauma is real. It's an inevitable part of what you do every day. But it's also treatable. There was an article in the New York Times this last year that said PTSD is not treatable. And I'm going to tell you that's not right, because it is. I also know that if you get help, if first responders get help, their lives are better. They're better at their jobs. And I'm asking all of us, take a look. Are you paying attention? When you see a first responder, do you see their heart? Do you see their courage? And to those men and those women, I want to say thank you.